where I worked in a county hospital. And shortly after that, and shortly meaning like after working there for about 5 to 7 years, being an assistant medical director, and at that time it was the busiest emergency department also in the Bay Area. I transitioned into medical education, where I started to teach not only at the bedside, but also doing some didactics. As you can imagine, this is very nerve-wracking for me, especially coming from a state school, going to a county hospital, to now working in this Center for Super Excellence. I felt this idea of the imposter phenomenon, where I kept on telling myself, I just have to fake it until I make it. And then I realized that actually this is a very common problem, not just in at Stanford, but also in medicine. I also realized that at Stanford, the said Center for Super Excellence, we also have something called the Stanford Duck Syndrome. It seems like we've mastered faking it until you make it, that everyone looks as if we are simply floating serenely in a pond. The reality, though, is that we're all struggling one way or another. We're just trying to flutter away under the water just to keep afloat. And so many of us have this failure resume that we don't even get to highlight, or we hide out of shame. And it also doesn't help that medical errors, especially before the pandemic, according to one study, was the third leading cause of death in the United States. And so even with the best care and intentions, bad outcomes happen. And so I think it's important to understand then that we are constantly working in a place where errors do happen. And often we're very hard on ourselves, a lot worse than how we would see the impact on other people or our colleagues. And so, in order to overcome this sense of burnout, you can't simply just resilience your way out of it. What I've realized, though, and what we've learned here at Stanford, Stanford WellMD does this health profession survey. And what they found is that self-compassion is protective against burnout. Now, it's important to understand that feeling compassion for ourselves in no way releases us from the responsibility of our actions. Rather, what it does is that it releases us from that self-hatred that prevents us from responding to our needs. We're able to see things clearer, and having this balanced perspective. Now, at Stanford WellMD, we talk about the three components required to achieve professional fulfillment. Number one, it's really important to understand that self-compassion is needed to developing this personal resilience. According to the 2016 Stanford Physician Wellness Survey of over 1,000 physicians, WellMD has found that physicians with the highest self-compassion have the lowest burnout. And so let me reiterate that. Doctors who practice self-compassion are less likely to feel burnout. The opposite is also true. Physicians who were experiencing burnout were found to have the lowest self-compassion. Several other surveys that WellMD has done supports this. What WellMD also found is that this idea of self-compassion or self-valuation, how you value yourself, has a dose-dependent impact on not only burnouts, but also sleep-related impairments. So the more we practice self-valuation, the less likely we will experience burnout, and we even start prioritizing our sleep even more. Now, Dr. Mickey Trockel, one of our colleagues here at WellMD, coined the idea of self-valuation, and he describes it as the prioritization of personal well-being coupled with this idea of growth mindsets, because we have to develop this growth mindset. as part of understanding our own personal imperfections. This idea that we can be better, we can improve, instead of simply being stuck on whatever deficiencies that we may have or lack of training. Now, I'm also grateful to work in a place where we have centers like the Center for Compassion and Altruism Research and Education. His Holiness the Dalai Lama is the co-founding benefactor. And what they found is that self-compassion is very difficult to teach. Now, I also took their applied compassion training. It's a 10-month intensive, learning about the science behind compassion. And I learned that it's easier for us to practice self-sacrifice, because after all, us high-performing professional self-sacrifice got us to where we are now. This means doing well in school or work, willing to compromise sleep, or even taking the simple time of enjoying the meal that we have, those basic necessities that are important for us to recharge, and yet we sacrifice them in order to simply address our competing priorities and responsibilities. What's also important to understand is that self-compassion can be done, and it takes intentionality and deliberate practice, and it also requires boundary setting. Now, I do want to acknowledge that some frustrations people have when they first start practicing self-compassion. This is what SeeCare has also found. Going through self-compassion practices may remind us of those triggers that we've compartmentalized, because these were experiences that we've blocked because we didn't want to deal with them in the first place. Now, I also want to clarify that self-compassion does not solve the actual problem. What it does is that it allows us to focus on what is within our control, which is including how we allow events to affect us. So self-compassion is not an act of offloading, but it allows us to create boundaries for ourselves. And self-compassion also means saying no to things, or being able to say not yet. Self-compassion does not mean that we just have to passively just be kind to everyone else at the expense of sacrificing ourselves. I think that when we start practicing self-compassion, we're able to pause and recognize what will be our next choice, instead of simply just allowing things to happen as they are. And also, we have to know that self-compassion is something that each and every one of us has access to. And again, we have that choice. We can either react to the stresses and events that we usually do through habits or learned reflexes, or we can be a lot more intentional and access compassion from within us. Now, Dr. Kristineff has done a lot of research in self-compassion. According to her, there are three components that we need. The first one is simply being kind to ourselves. We need to create this warm and understanding environment towards ourselves. And we have to practice to really take care of ourselves and not just ignore our pain. The second part is this concept of common humanity, this understanding that feeling inadequate or feeling like we're not good enough is actually a shared human experience, and that's something that we all go through, and that we are not alone in this experience. And the third, and I think one of the most important part, is this concept of mindfulness or self-awareness. It's really those micro moments of being present and having that balanced perspective to the feelings that we're experiencing. So we're not over-identifying or exaggerating the feelings that we're experiencing. We're simply noticing whenever we're being tough on ourselves. Self-compassion validates the feelings that we're experiencing, and it also helps us dismantle that shame that I was talking about earlier. So why do we care about this? Let's talk about this in the context of the talk today, which is the understanding of the future of medicine. And with this, I'm going to use the concepts that Dr. Tate Schoenfeld, our chief wellness officer here at Stanford. And we'll start with the era of distress, where at that time, and many of you probably can relate to this, there's lack of awareness to physician well-being. And really, there's no attention to the impact of physician distress on patients. We just have to focus on patients. And so we were expected to be perfect, right? In fact, many people then, many doctors then, thought of themselves as gods. Some of these practices are even still in place, right? The doctor has the final word. In fact, the patient does not die until the doctor pronounces that they are dead. And then also, because we've created this sense of exclusiveness, we created also rites of passages. We haze people in order to prove themselves that they are just as good as everybody else to be a doctor. And so there's also a focus on the institutional needs, right? We don't care what the doctors are experiencing. We just want to make sure that the hospital thrives and continues to exist. And so what this means is that I mentioned earlier that medical errors is the third leading cause of death in the United States. That means those errors are focused on naming and blaming and shaming individual doctors and clinicians. And so what do we do instead during the era of distress? We just have to do self-care. Maybe in order for me to avoid burnout, I just need to take a break, or I just need to take a vacation, right? It's all on me to take care of myself. And so we blame the individuals for the distress that they're experiencing because it's their personal weakness. Also, when we talk about the physician-administration relationship, there's really no relationship. It's a matter of neglect. Physicians didn't care about the administrator, and the administrators didn't care about the physicians. Also, because there's no communication, right? There's just this expectation that doctors can just do everything. There's no limits on their work. It didn't matter that overworking or the work compression leads to physicians feeling distress. Also, again, we ignore approaches to individual distress because it's just a personal weakness. They should just take care of that on their own. We don't even utilize technology to help us improve the way that we work with interface with our patients. And also, there's not a lot of studies on mental health or depression. And really, there's no resource allocation specific to physician wellness. So now let's move on to the next era, which is well-being 1.0. Many of us actually experience this right now. There is some appreciation of the implications of physician distress. So we appreciate it now instead of just ignoring it. Instead of the culture of perfection, there is a culture of wellness. We care about people now. Instead of using rites of passage, we actually use like frameworks like competency-based practice. And we focus on the patient needs instead of the institution, right? It's not just the bottom line. But the patient is always right in this era, right? And in terms of taking care of our distress, then we now start seeing teams instead of just self-care. We start thinking of personal resilience instead of just like taking care of yourself individually. There are still, instead of like focusing on blaming the individual, we start to appreciate that maybe the system can cause some distress and maybe we can figure out ways for the individual to solve the problem. So the system is somewhat involved, but it's still on the individual to fix things. Many of you have seen this slide, right? And instead of looking at doctors as deities or gods, now we're looked up as heroes. Definitely the pandemic has highlighted many commercials and billboards about this. There's this, and then when we talk about like physician and administrator relationship, we start seeing this adversarial relationship. This is us versus them. The administrators should fix this, or the doctors are just being lazy. They need to work harder, right? And so there's constant blaming of each other. However, we start realizing in Wellbeing 1.0 that there's actually limits to our work. And so we start working on this idea of work-life balance. And as you many of you know, it's a struggle to balance work and life, because it makes me feel like I'm choosing personal life over work, or vice versa. If I take care of my family, then I must not care about my work, right? Instead of focusing on isolation, which is what we experience as physicians, in Wellbeing 1.0, we start talking about connections, the relationship that we have with each other. And then we start treating this individual distress that we're experiencing. We start understanding some tips and tricks to optimize the EHR system, the electronic health record, right? And then, of course, now that we're investing in physician well-being, because it's a necessary cost to mitigate the stress. So I'm highlighting this because we have to understand the past, even though we can't change that. And now we're here. And instead of dwelling on the past, instead of getting caught up with the judgments of, yeah, that was back then, like it was a bad time, the past is already spoken for. And so now is the moment where we can refocus our energy. And so let's talk about Wellbeing 2.0. Instead of simply being aware of physician distress, let's create actions instead of just talking about it. Because we have to appreciate that we have chosen a hard path, right? And that's in this work that we do, we have to start taking care of the experiences that we have as well. Instead of simply blaming administrators for the experiences that we have to work together to create solutions. This also requires us to embrace this culture of vulnerability, the culture of self-compassion, right? Instead of just saying like, oh, we embrace this culture of wellness, we actually embrace this culture of self-compassion that we talked about. Because sometimes micro failures in our career are simply just that. Instead of blowing it out of proportion, we can see it as like, hey, we're actually in the right trajectory. And we can create systems that focuses on autonomy, belonging, and competence. And we need to create this environment that really focuses on advancing well-being at the leadership level. So creating infrastructure and leadership to advance well-being. Instead of simply expecting people to fit in, we can create environments where we can focus on valuing uniqueness and creating this sense of belongingness. One example of that is creating mentoring programs. This is a program that we've developed during the pandemic, specifically supporting those underrepresented in medicine. And it's also important to recognize that physicians are not heroes only, right? We're not superheroes. We're just as human as everybody else, with human qualities like getting tired or exhausted when we work too much, or getting stressed out when there's so many things expected of us that's beyond our control. And also, we have to include this organizational environments that supports coaching, for instance, developing competence and the holistic approach to the clinicians. Including investing in them to prioritize their growth as well. And it's not just the patient is always right. It's actually not just patient-centered care, but relationship-centered care. Focusing on the needs of the people, both the physicians and the patients, right? Because there's a reason why you went to medical school, and there's a reason why you trained so hard to learn your craft. And so you cannot just like take that aside and compromise that when you take care of our patients. So as we find this balance between personal and professional life, we have to also learn that integration may be that place which requires balancing and setting boundaries and healthy limits. Because including setting limits is setting time to disconnect and maybe taking a vacation instead of just hoping that maybe tomorrow I'll be better. And we can use our values to even allow us to set those boundaries. And when we look at the work-life integration or harmony, we can start seeing things in gauges like the health or the work or the love and the play instead of just work and life. And again, just as work is important, there are also other things that we have to attend to, like spending time with our family or friends and pursue hobbies and other non-related work interests. Including these non-work related activities in the calendar can also be helpful because then all of a sudden it looks like our calendar is a lot brighter. I love this slide to remind me of how to say no. So I learned this from Dr. Esther Chu. There's three things that I now consider when I take on a task or a new role. Number one, the question is it good for me? Is it good for my boss? Is my boss going to be happy? And the third one is, will it help me advance my career? And so now I realize that there's many of these opportunities, especially at Stanford. And so I'm stuck with like feeling overwhelmed about so many different opportunities and choices. So now I added the fourth one, which is, can I fit it in my schedule? And which of this in my schedule do I need to move to replace with this new opportunity? And so now I start taking vacations. Well, I've always been taking vacations, but now I start taking vacations and letting people know that. So this is an example of my away message when I took a break last year. And here's another one. And developing, not just me modeling this, but creating initiatives to encourage everyone to take true vacation, right? Instead of just like kind of sneaking away and being with your family or whatever vacation you want to spend your time. As we look into well-being 2.0, we have to look at regulations and administrative decisions as influenced by those of the people that work for them, right? So the needs of the clinicians. We have to also start developing new models of team-based communication, team-based documentation, and then improving EHR. So working with the vendors to demand a better product instead of just dealing with what we have, right? And then testing systems-level intervention to mitigate the stress and promote, again, physician well-being. And so we have to pivot. And maybe this includes pivoting our own career. So for me, I switched from medical education as a residency program, associate residency program director to director of well-being. I also started being leading our human potential team, where our goal is to really find alignment for individuals and teams in alignment with our institution's values and mission. Because when we start talking about understanding our values, we can make habits out of them. I started learning about design thinking. I took a fellowship in the Stanford By Design program. And one of the cool things that I get to do is now apply those by design or design thinking methodologies, including being able to fail fast and fail often, right? In the interventions that I do as a well-being director. Most of the things that I tackle are going to be dilemmas with no clear solutions. And so I have to be kinder to myself as a leader in order to continue to iterate and prototype different ways of advancing. There's also the notion of false fail. Maybe it didn't work out this time, but in another setting, in another environment, in another group of people, we can test it out again, which really leads to that growth mindset, that aspect of self-valuation, that we're not stuck on who we are. There's always room for us to improve with kindness. So when we deal with resuscitations at Stanford, for instance, and the patient dies, instead of just allowing people to take care of themselves and go their merry ways after they leave that room, we now set up diffusion sessions to acknowledge the different emotions that exist after a resuscitation. Many of you are also familiar with M&M, right? And again, most of them are focused on the naming, blaming, and shaming. And so we change that into really understanding what are human factors and what are systems causes. And yet, when we reach out to our colleagues about errors that have happened or a critical incident, we have to normalize that these are common things and that it can be distressing to get this email. And so it's just adding a little kindness in the way that we communicate with each other. Because it also is important to understand that, like, not everybody will have mental illness. However, what's also important is that in the spectrum of our mental health, there will be good days and bad days. And we have to tend to ourselves. We have to take care of ourselves. At the national level, we partner with different emergency medicine organizations to stop the stigma for emergency physicians to seek mental health. Again, we start using statements like, we're not superheroes. We're just as human as everybody else. And it takes all of us to change that culture. We also start recognizing and appreciating the other end of the spectrum, right? Because just as M&M is important, we also start highlighting the saves of the months. And it's never just one person who led that save. It's actually the entire team. So we start recognizing people and recognizing those moments of self-awareness when we feel those goosebumps, when things are actually doing well, and reminding our colleagues, like, hey, this is how it feels like to save a life. I do more of this work in this conference that we host, in creating this community of high-performance teams, because medical errors will continue to happen. But we can also design an environment where we can create gratitude and appreciation for each other, and also take time to celebrate ourselves, including taking a break, including recognizing when we are feeling overwhelmed and taking the steps to actually manage that. And not just put it on the individual to handle that, but creating systems to allow for people to be taken care of. So at Stanford, I direct the Physician Resource Network. It's our peer support program to not just treat the stress, but actually proactively creating these healing sessions to allow people to continue to prevent the accumulation of this unappreciated, unrecognized trauma that we are experiencing every day. It's okay to feel overwhelmed and to struggle a bit. It's okay to struggle a lot. And it's also okay to not be okay. And that there's a community around us that will help us get there. That, I believe, is well-being 2.0, a place where we can find meaning and purpose. And even though, as you hear this, it must be this, like, overwhelming, I hope that you can also know that you can start somewhere. And you don't have to create big, amazing, wonderful things immediately. You can start with the 1% of that amazing and wonderful things. Because incremental efforts counts as an improvement in our environment. Now, I started with a picture of me in Montevideo, and I don't want to highlight that as like a past, because I think that we cannot just ignore the past also. What is important is for us to embrace the past that we've had and allow that to give us the wisdom to practice compassion in an environment that we are currently in and also the future of medicine. And so I hope that this talk has given you a sense of hope. I love my job. This is the hard path that we chose. I'm not the best. I don't have to be. I am enough. Thank you.
Gracias, profesor Álvarez, por esta excelente presentación, muy reflexiva, que sin duda nos, en tanto el auditorio presente como el que está siguiendo por la web, nos ha generado pensar en nuestra práctica, en nuestra vida profesional y la importancia de temas de cuidar la salud también de los equipos de salud, un tema de bienestar sin duda, pero que está asociado a otras variables como la seguridad del paciente, como la relación humana del usuario, en relación con el usuario y los equipos de salud. Interesante la presentación y seguramente ahora el profesor Dapueto nos permitirá seguir pensando y reflexionando sobre este tema.
Muchas gracias, un desafío. ¿Podemos poner la imagen del doctor Álvarez compartiendo la pantalla? ¿Podemos poner la imagen de él, las dos? ¿La sala y la imagen de él? Ah, doctor Álvarez, we would like to see you. Ahí está, ¿verdad? Bien, ahí está, ahí lo estamos viendo. Nosotros por lo menos lo vemos. Bien, entonces agradecer al doctor Álvarez. ¿Qué tal? Buenas tardes. ¿Nos escuchas bien? ¿Escuchas bien la traducción? ¿Escuchas bien la traducción? Trinidad dice, si estás escuchando la traducción. ¿Nos escuchas? No escuché. No, está bien, pero ¿nos escuchas? Sí, bien. Entonces, gracias por la hermosa presentación en la que, bueno, comienza combinando aspectos de su contexto personal, de su experiencia en la medicina. El gran trabajo y el compromiso con la promoción del bienestar y que también es una fuente de inspiración y de esperanza en el futuro de la medicina. Una medicina orientada a mejores resultados en términos de bienestar y de calidad de vida para los pacientes y también para los integrantes de los equipos de salud. También agradecer a la academia en la persona de nuestro presidente por haber destinado este espacio a este tema y para incluir este tema del bienestar médico en estas sesiones que tienen que ver con el futuro de la práctica médica. El doctor Álvarez ha enfocado en los cambios de la cultura de la medicina y en las estrategias de afrontamiento al estrés que es necesario poner en juego. Esto que habla de la resiliencia, que es necesario poner en juego en el ejercicio de una profesión que genera estrés por la responsabilidad que implica el cuidado de la salud de las personas. Y además en contextos de alta exigencia, como puede ser la emergencia o como puede ser la medicina intensiva, o todas las especialidades médicas en general, ¿no? Lo que quisiera ahora es tratar de contextualizar o enfocar sobre cómo y en qué medida estos cambios se están produciendo en nuestro país, o sea, en qué medida nosotros estamos encaminados en este camino hacia el futuro del bienestar. Entonces, voy a empezar por la toma de conciencia, esto que se llama el awareness, sobre la necesidad del autocuidado. Y él en esto introduce el término autocompasión como un aspecto que debe ser tenido en cuenta. La autocompasión no como autocomplacencia, no como vale todo, sino autocompasión en el sentido de compasión hacia uno mismo. Compasión tiene que ver con el concepto de empatía. La empatía es más un concepto que tiene que ver con lo cognitivo, ponerse en el lugar del otro, ponerse en los zapatos del otro y entender la realidad desde la perspectiva del otro. Compasión incluye eso, incluye sentir el sufrimiento del otro como nuestro sufrimiento, pero además hacer un movimiento hacia la acción. Eso es autocompasión. Eso es compasión. Y autocompasión es hacer eso mismo hacia nosotros mismos. Es tratarnos a nosotros con la misma amabilidad que trataríamos a otras personas. Entonces, en esto de intervenciones dirigidas a este cambio de actitudes, en nuestro país se vienen desarrollando desde hace ya bastante tiempo actividades que tienen que ver con esto, ¿no? Con fomentar la resiliencia, pero también con fomentar el autocuidado, tanto a nivel de las personas como de las unidades clínicas o de las unidades académicas. Hay talleres de prevención del burnout, hay programas de reducción del estrés basado en mindfulness, lo que se llama Mindfulness-Based Stress Reduction Programs. Hay también programas de self-compassion y mindfulness, o sea, autocompasión y mindfulness. Cuando se habla de mindfulness, de lo que estamos hablando es de la atención, de momentos dedicados a la atención plena. O sea, a la atención plena en cómo está siendo nuestra experiencia en este momento. A eso nos dirigimos con, ¿no? A eso se refiere cuando se habla de mindfulness. Y también hay talleres de prevención del burnout, y hay talleres de prevención del suicidio, y hay talleres de posvención en el suicidio de integrantes del equipo de salud en un país como el nuestro, donde las tasas de suicidio en la población son muy altas, y entre la población médica suponemos que son altas, aunque nunca hemos podido tener el dato, o por más que lo hemos pedido. A nivel de las unidades académicas, y hablo de las unidades académicas de la Facultad de Medicina de la UDELAR, se trabaja mucho, tanto desde el Observatorio de Comportamientos Profesionales, que tiene como objetivo promover buenas prácticas profesionales, y para promover buenas prácticas profesionales tienen que darse en contextos de bienestar. Si uno está en contextos no saludables, no puede tener buenas prácticas profesionales, ni tampoco asegurar, velar por la seguridad del paciente. También desde la Comisión de Bienestar de Residentes y Posgrados, que se formó hace ya 3 años, desde que estaba en la dirección el profesor Francisco González, que tiene que ver con esto, con crear instancias donde se trabaja sobre el bienestar en los posgrados, residentes y posgrados. Las sociedades científicas se han comprometido durante todo el tiempo de la pandemia en velar por el bienestar de sus asociados y han hecho un montón de actividades que tienen que ver con esto. Otro aspecto muy importante que presentó el doctor Álvarez se refiere al cambio de la cultura de la medicina a lo largo de, yo diría, 50 años, ¿no? Desde esta bienestar de la era del distrés de hace 50 años para atrás, a lo que viene siendo el arribo de esta etapa del bienestar 1.0, hasta lo que sería la medicina del futuro, donde aspiramos a un bienestar del 2.0. Esto de médicos en la etapa del distrés, de hacemos todo en todo momento sin decir que no y nos consideramos semidioses y acá nadie se deprime, acá nadie se cansa, acá nadie tiene problemas con nada y nadie se suicida, a una etapa donde, bueno, tenemos que cuidar de nosotros porque nuestro trabajo no nos puede enfermar, porque tenemos que estar bien para cuidar a otros, que sería el 1.0, hasta esta etapa en la cual tenemos una generación de médicos jóvenes que eligen cuándo y cómo quieren trabajar. Y ayer en el café estábamos hablando con la doctora Irene Litvan, que esto pasa acá y esto pasa allá y pasa en todos lados. Y está generando conflictos intergeneracionales y prejuicios, ¿no? Yo no quiero repetir lo que ustedes hicieron, dicen los jóvenes, y los viejos dicen son unos haraganes, ¿no? Son unos irresponsables, no se hacen cargo de sus responsabilidades. Y esto creo que lo dejo como una pregunta para que lo comentemos en el tiempo que tenemos después. Pero quiero enfatizar sobre algo que el doctor Álvarez no dijo, pero que está implícito en su charla, en su presentación. Y es el tema del compromiso de los líderes de las instituciones. Porque lo que tenemos acá, en el doctor Eley Álvarez, es un líder comprometido, un champion, como dirían los norteamericanos, del bienestar. Nos habla de programas, nos habla de una institución comprometida, nos habla de mejorar la comunicación con los administradores. y entonces y de velar, o sea, una institución que es de súper exigencia, pero que ha desarrollado estrategias y programas e intervenciones para velar por el bienestar. Y en esto yo sé que puedo ser un poco, en fin, generar un poco de discrepancias, pero en nuestro país estamos tan lejos de esto. Acá tenemos que reconocer que no solamente no hemos avanzado, sino que probablemente hayamos estado retrocediendo. Nuestras organizaciones de salud, y esto es mi opinión personal y no compromete la opinión de nadie, siguen implementando modelos de gestión que no contemplan estos aspectos. Se sigue manejando con esquemas de autoritarismo, de escasa participación de los sujetos en cuanto a propuestas organizacionales. Uno debería poder trabajar en instituciones donde se siente escuchado y se siente que puede aportar y se siente que sus planteos pueden ser incluidos como por lo menos parte de las propuestas a discutir, en la toma de decisiones, en los objetivos asistenciales, en los aspectos organizativos. Bueno, ¿y qué decir del reconocimiento? Porque luego de los fugaces fuegos artificiales, de los aplausos durante la pandemia, las cosas dieron marcha atrás. Y lo que en un momento fue el reconocimiento del esfuerzo y del enorme trabajo y el compromiso que los equipos de salud tuvieron durante la pandemia, se volvió demasiado rápido a la vieja normalidad, cuando esperábamos una nueva normalidad. No existen programas, avances en el bienestar médico, no vamos a llegar a una cultura del 2.0 realmente con logros si los líderes no se comprometen, si los mandos altos y medios de las instituciones de salud, así como de las instituciones educativas, no se comprometen con estos cambios. Esto lo dicen todos los que trabajan en desarrollar programas. Sin el compromiso de los líderes, no hay cambios. Por último, una reflexión sobre este concepto tan interesante de en esto de en qué camino nos encontramos en la medicina del futuro, desde la medicina centrada en el médico, donde el paciente no tenía ningún rol, ninguna capacidad de decisión, hasta en declararlo muerto, como nos decía Elaine, a la medicina centrada en el paciente. La Academia de Medicina de Estados Unidos elaboró un trabajo muy, muy interesante de guías para mejorar la brecha en la calidad en el año 2000, y el foco estaba puesto en la medicina centrada en el paciente. Y ahora él nos plantea algo muy interesante, que es la medicina centrada en la relación, donde es importante tomar en cuenta el bienestar y la calidad de vida de nuestros pacientes, tanto como es necesario considerar el bienestar y la calidad de vida del personal médico y de los equipos médicos. Y acaba de salir, no, pero en el 2019, 20 años después de aquella guía, la Academia de Medicina, que forma parte de la Academia de Ciencias de Estados Unidos, saca un nuevo volumen enorme dedicado ¿a qué? A la prevención del burnout. O sea, la preocupación ahora es esta, porque el problema es que si no atendemos esto, nos vamos a quedar sin recursos en salud altamente calificados, porque los jóvenes no van a querer repetir el camino que le hemos dejado y van a optar por aquellas circunstancias donde se les ofrece no ni mejor dinero, ni mejor prestigio académico, sino mejor vida. Así que yo le agradezco a Ley que nos haya dejado todas estas reflexiones tan removedoras y que tenemos que nos deja como una antorcha que tenemos que llevar adelante encendida en nuestro entorno. Muchas gracias.
Gracias, académico de Apuesto. No sé si dentro de esta sala hay algunas reflexiones, preguntas. Yo entiendo que principalmente, más que preguntas, deben de existir reflexiones sobre la temática.
Thank you very much, Professor. I'm going to speak Spanish for the rest of the audience. ¿Han encontrado diferencias en self-compassion entre varones y mujeres? Y en caso de ser así, ¿han encontrado mejor o peor capacidad de mejorar la self-compassion entre varones y mujeres?
Thank you for that question. I think that there's certainly there are differences with how different genders are comfortable with vulnerability. There is that cultural expectation for men, for instance, to be stoic, to not share. And so even in our work here at Stanford, what we've done is we've tried to put it in groups. So for instance, for the compassion cultivation training, we've even considered just having physician-only compassion cultivation training because it allows physicians to feel comfortable sharing what they're experiencing. As you know, in the work of Brené Brown, men in general are not very comfortable with sharing their vulnerability. However, we have to go beyond that. I think we have to start seeing things as these are all experiences that we can all share. That's again, in self-compassion, that common humanity, whether you're man or woman, or depending on the generation, as Dr. Dapueto also pointed out, I think that sometimes it's easier to just say like, maybe men should just focus on this or women should focus on this, or the older generation or the newer generation. What I'm trying to say is each of us has the capacity to be kinder for ourselves. And you're right, when in learning that, there may be some resistance initially, but in my experience, the people who truly practice self-compassion, it's not really about their gender or who they are. It's just a matter of that simple practice of being intentional about taking care of yourself as well and being kind to yourself.
Profesor Dapueto, no sé si quiere hacer alguna.
No, ningún comentario.
Un comentario para que tiene relación con las dos excelentes últimas conferencias. Cuando Manrique hacía sus coplas y decía que todo tiempo pasado fue mejor, nunca recordamos la frase que la palabra que decía antes de esa frase. Decía, según nuestra experiencia, o sea, según nuestro parecer, todo tiempo pasado fue mejor. O sea que no es cierto, es lo que nos parece. En esa línea está muy ligado a lo que tú decías acerca de que los jóvenes interpretan, no nos entienden y nosotros decimos que son unos vagos. Y en ese ida y vuelta generacional, el problema somos nosotros, creo yo. No son los jóvenes. Los jóvenes no necesitan líderes soñadores, que el macho francés, todo eso, por eso lo tienen en el celular. O sea, no necesitan toda esa carga que venimos nosotros, creo yo. Creo que los jóvenes necesitan líderes que los contengan, que los ayuden en su estrés, que los acompañen, que se involucren con ellos y que les permitan desarrollar lo que ellos quieren desarrollar. Ellos ya no quieren seguir órdenes. No se les puede decir, hace esto porque yo soy el gran profesor y te lo digo. La pregunta, la primera que deben decir es, ¿y por qué? Y esto es fenomenal. Y no estamos capacitados para ese liderazgo moderno. Yo creo que el gran problema en este momento, creo yo que somos nosotros. O sea, creo que las cosas, excusas tengo muchas y tenemos muchas. Pasó todo demasiado rápido, todo cambió demasiado rápido. Nos preparamos para un líder, nuestros líderes nos prepararon para un mundo que hoy ya no existe. Entonces, es entendible, pero tenemos un grave problema y creo que tendríamos que hacer muchos cursos para nosotros más que para los jóvenes. Yo sé que esto es medio disruptivo, yo sé que esto por ahí no está bien decirlo, pero creo que tenemos que hacer una autocrítica profunda nuestra y tenemos que tratar de crear nuevos líderes, posiblemente sub 50, para que cuando tengan la necesidad del o lleguen al liderazgo estén preparados como no estuvimos nosotros. El problema está es quién va a dar esa preparación. No lo sé.
Un
Eso
comentario,
Perales, Perales.
if I may,
Una frase.
I would just add that I think there is, it's common to confuse the well-being 2.0 that the 2.0 should be the future generation. I think it's actually important to realize that well-being 2.0 can be happening now with all of us, including the different generations that we have in medicine. And so one of the things that I learned in the Mission Critical Teams Institute is this idea of robustness, resilience, and mindfulness. And they break it down into generations. There's the generation of robustness when you're punched, you just withstand it, you just don't fall. And then there's the generation of resilience that if you get punched and if you fall, you just get up. And then there's also the generation of mindfulness when if you know you're going to get punched, why put your face in front of the fist, right? So you might as well just move away. And so the goal here is to understand that we can actually be all three of them. We can develop robustness, we can re develop resilience, and we can develop mindfulness. And part of this is, again, moving away from that us versus them, that like it's my generation against the other generations. And instead, we can all figure out to work together. And as Dr. Dapuero said, this requires training of leaders, but also training of ourselves, not only to be kinder to ourselves, but also to improve that growth mindset, that we are all capable of improving, because that's what we do, especially in academia. We're constantly trying to evolve and adapt to an environment that is that we're experiencing.
Profesor, sí, tiene la palabra. Perales.
Congratulations for your very important talk. I have only one question. I do find that what you have described is happening only in the medical institution, or this is a society problem? Is the society which is ill?
It's an important question to ask if this is, it's a great question to ask if this is just a problem in medicine versus a problem in the society in general. I think the issue here is that even though it's happening in society, the way that we respond to it in medicine is also very different because we're a lot more conservative. Because we worry about that patient-centered care and how it'll impact our patients, which often then means that we have to sacrifice our own well-being. We have to sacrifice our own training. And that is not true for many other work out there, right? If you think about it, there's no other work that will tolerate just working extra to the point of not eating, not taking breaks, compared to what we do in medicine. Maybe back in the days, that was the case in many other workforce, but that's not true in medicine. I think that the current issue is that we need, as physicians in medicine, we need to also figure out a way to humanize ourselves in how we address the societal problems, including the generational impact of change. And that requires not for the physicians to change, but for the leaders to really the institution to create systems that will support physicians when they make decisions that also prioritize themselves instead of only doing things for their patients.
Thank you.
Estamos
Profesor Dapueto.
llegamos a la hora. Bueno, dos cosas. Sin duda, los cambios en la medicina no son ajenos a los cambios que se están produciendo en la sociedad, lo cual genera, además, conflicto dentro de los mismos jóvenes, porque la vida que hacen los jóvenes médicos, desde que entran a la facultad de medicina y hasta que se jubilan, es muy distinta de la vida que hacen los otros conciudadanos, de los otros jóvenes, ¿no? Un joven, aprendí esto de los jóvenes, un joven cualquiera de arquitectura, de ciencias sociales, de cualquier otra facultad universitaria, puede ser un hipster, puede ser alguien que tiene una vida donde no hay objetivos, donde no hay tiempo, donde no hay ni tiempo ni espacio, sino que tampoco hay proyectos, y la noción de progreso obviamente hace mucho que se perdió. Pero estos que pueden estar conversando hasta las 4 de la mañana, si es un estudiante de medicina, a las 7 y media tiene que estar en el hospital poniéndose la túnica para ir a la sala a las 8. O sea, también hay discrepancias en el joven que estudia medicina se convierte en un ser diferente de sus pares de la misma edad, universitarios. Lo cual también te sería bueno para hacer una sesión con jóvenes médicos y preguntarles cómo se sienten ellos con respecto a sus pares. La otra cosa es que quisiera retomar la palabra del final, esperanza, ¿verdad? Y entonces quiero contarles, y de paso agradecerle a la licenciada profesora adjunta Mercedes Viera, que está acá presente, el contacto con el EI, pero además contarles que con Mercedes estamos trabajando con dos clínicas de la Facultad de Medicina. En una de ellas tenemos una persona de 50 años que es al mismo tiempo una persona extremadamente destacada, esa persona, en su especialidad. Y a su vez extremadamente exigente con sus residentes. Y entonces, obviamente, esa combinación puede ser tremenda, ¿no? Para el bienestar de los residentes. Pero hasta que esta persona se dio cuenta que también era importante para su propio bienestar. Y entonces ahora, con esa autoexigencia que tiene, nos está enseñando a nosotros, cuando nosotros le decimos, pero hay que darle reconocimiento a esta gente, a estos residentes. No hay que solamente mostrarles esos errores, hay que también reconocer el esfuerzo. Y entonces, claro, reconocer es como solamente señalar aquello cuando ya no está mal. No, no, hay que decir también lo que está bien. Y entonces ahora nos encontramos que cuando hablamos de reconocimiento, ella nos dice, estuve estudiando y ahora sé qué áreas del cerebro se ponen en activación cuando alguien me reconoce. Entonces, tenemos a esta persona altamente exigente, muy buena en su especialidad, que ahora está estudiando el efecto del reconocimiento y de decir cosas amables en el cerebro de sus residentes y lo está haciendo muy profesionalmente y muy bien. Claro, ahora que es amable, se cuestiona por qué los residentes no reconocen tal amabilidad. Bueno, todo lleva tiempo, todo lleva tiempo. Pero hay esperanza, no solamente con los más jóvenes, sino como decía Ley, hay esperanzas en todas las generaciones, porque todos podemos aprender de esto.
Académico Arcos.
Bueno, muchas gracias, profesor Álvarez, por tan removedora charla y por el contacto desde remoto, desde Estados Unidos. Muchas gracias, académico de Puerto y académico Tomasina, y damos por concluida esta sesión.